Hi everybody, my name is William Beam, and I'm going to take a first look at Intensify Pro from MacPhun. And the first thing you want to know is that if you're not using a Mac, this software is not for you. The folks who created this have done a remarkable job. It's very simple, it's easy to use. You can use this with Photoshop, with Lightroom, or Aperture, but it also works as a standalone, and that's the way I'm using it right now. So quite literally, you can open a photo or just open up Intensify Pro and drag a photo on top. In this case, I have, you can see over here, a rather large image. It's a 36 megapixel D800 shot. And quite simply, if you want to, you can just come over here, look at the ribbon bar. We can see open images, so you can select your photos and grab whatever you need to. You have multiple sharing options if you want to export off to Flickr, Facebook, SmugMug, a number of features. But also you've got some options here to open it in some of the other applications from MacPhun or also from Adobe or Aperture. Once you're completed with the photo, this little thing that looks like a present is actually kind of a cute little idea. You've got a print lab built into this application. Postcards, note cards, gallery frames, and canvas prints. So we can take a look at that in more detail later on. Right now, I'm simply just kind of pointing out that it's there. The next button comes on over here is gives you a little zoom window, so you can zoom in and out that way if that's what you prefer. Or we can close that off, and we can just simply hit the fit button to show it full size. We can zoom into 100% crop, or we can be a little more gradual with the plus and minus magnifying bars. And also down here, you'll see a zoom window that lets you choose specific settings. So this eye will show a little bit later on. Essentially, you can see it's a quick preview. When we go into masking, it'll show us a reveal of what the layer mask looks on here. The next one will give you a before and after compare, and you can just hit this or hit the semicolon. And of course, you've got your undo and redo options. Finally, along the top, you can see the hand in case you want to move your image around. Let's see if we can't move it up, so we've got a little option right there. You've got your option to brush the effects in, erase them out, and there's also a gradient that's built in. So if you want to use an effect as a gradient, you can do that as well. But for right now, let's take a look at how you actually put this together. So I've got the brush selected, and you can see the brush gives you traditional kind of look of your softness and size. The usual Adobe commands, for example, the brackets will make it larger and smaller. If you hold down the shift key and hit your brackets, you can see that it changes the softness or hardness of the brush. There is also layers available. By default, you start off with one layer. And if you want to, you can just hit the plus button, add another layer. And there's a layer mask along with it. So not only can you provide all of these effects that are on here globally through the image, but if you want to do something selectively, those layer masks and the brush or erase tool will let you take care of that. So the next thing that's really of interest are the choice between using the presets and using the adjustments. What you're going to find is there are plenty of both. There are things to like and dislike depending upon the image that you're using. So for example, let me open up a few of these. I've got a portrait of a lovely young model. Some of the tools that might be available to you here may work on images you don't want, and they may not. So you can kind of pick and choose your favorites. Dark details, young model, not a good choice. But there are a few other things on here that I do like. And, oh, pretty much whenever you see spicy, bad choice. And my apologies to the model. What I do like, though, are some of the ones over here that are almost like quick fixes. For example, you can see I've marked a little star over here to mark this as a favorite for pro quality. And right off the bat, we can see a quick change. So let's hit the before and after, and you can see just that's rather flat. All of a sudden, we've got some sharpness. We've got a little bit of color boost over here, and there's more detail in our hair. It's kind of a nice, quick, easy way to just add a little bit of bop to an image. Detail enhancement is another one of my favorites. Let me go ahead and reset this image back to the default. This is straight out of camera, and right out of the box, this is one of my favorite presets, Tack Sharp. Just take a look at the eyes on the model and her blouse. When I hit this, suddenly everything just pops. this may be too much for areas that you don't want. So for example, there is also under here on the soft, you can see there's a soften skin tool. So this is where having layers and the ability to selectively add the adjustments is what you would probably want to use. So let me go back and reset this. And I'm going to leave the bottom layer as the default. And we're going to add the plus key, hit the top layer, and let me close up some of these. And we're going to apply tack sharp. So again, it does the entire image, but I don't necessarily want everything that sharp. So I'm going to select my brush tool, and I'm going to change the size just a little bit. And I'll brush in some sharpness on our hair. Let me come down here, brush it in on our eyes. And also under our lips and just around our nose right there. So selectively, there are some areas that you want sharp, you want the edges to show up. And I'm also going to do it on our blouse, just to add a little bit more pop to that. And trying to avoid her skin. It's not necessarily the smoothest brush in the world, but let's take a look at that. We'll hit the slash key, and you can see the mask. It, you know, it's almost comic relief right there. But you can see effectively the areas that you've covered and the areas that you haven't. So let me turn that off, and then let's take a look at our preview. So if I hold down the backslash key, you can see that's our native image, and when I let go of it, that's the changes we made. You could do the same thing with a hand, and just kind of click the image, and then once you let it go, it'll come right back up. We'll go back. And of course, over on the layers, you can just simply turn off the layer that you want and see what the changes you made were. One of the things I really like about all of these presets, if you notice over here at Tack Sharp, you see the amount. Basically, this is an opacity slider. So if it's too much for what you want, you can just brush in the whole thing and then just back it off to the level that you feel is comfortable. So you don't necessarily have to go for the full-on eyes blazing at you like that. You can sharpen it a little bit and then pull it back. And you'll still find, when you do your before and after, there's just a subtle change there. But sometimes those subtle changes are the ones that have the most impact. It's just... is not enough with without the sharpening. It's a little too much on this particular subject with the full thing. So I pulled it down to about plus 46. So somewhere in the middle was where my happy ground. With that in mind, also you can continue to add other layers and add other effects. So we'll hit the plus key again and hit it once a little too many times there. Let me back off. Let's go over here to boost colors. Again, suddenly her blouse is just really popping up. Her face is a bit too much. And I'm trying to decide where's the fine line? I think I would like to, well, let's pull these colors back a little bit. So again, you can see how it changes. I might actually like her blouse with that extra color, but that's all I want. So once again, we're gonna come up here and make sure we've got our brush selected and just simply brush in. By default, you see when you select a tool, it gives you a global application. As soon as you start brushing, the layer mask turns black, your brush is assumed to be white, and you just start brushing in. You can hit the X key if you go over an edge or something like that, and you can just kind of take off or take away what you want to, and that'll undo the mask. So you've got pretty much the same tools. If you're used to using this in Photoshop or other applications that use these tools, it works here as well. So we've just got our mask there. Let's see, do I want to do our hair? Maybe, maybe not. We're just kind of playing around here a little bit. So let me undo a little bit right over there. And let's take a look at our layer mask. So we've got more or less, wrong side, more or less kind of what I was looking for. It's not pretty. There's no refined edge that I'm aware of with this brush where you can make the selections quite the way you would in Photoshop. But the results are still actually pretty good. I mean, within just a very short amount of time, we brought this image in here. We've added some sharpness, we've added some color boost, and it's just made the subject pop out of the background all that much more. Now, we can, pretty much if you want to, you can work just with the presets and come up with some very nice images. But the power of this tool is over here in the adjustment side. Keep in mind, the layer that you have selected is what you're adjusting. So if I decided to start playing with the color temperature
it's only affecting the parts that I've masked. And you can double click to reset that back to normal, or you can just hit each adjustment has a little reset right there to bring them back to normal as well. So if you want to make an adjustment globally, and if you left yourself a layer at the bottom, you could do that, and we could hit the color temperature and just kind of warm things up a little bit, or a lot. Or we can just reset that right back to where we were. And if you want to turn things, each of these adjustments on or off, you've got a little checkbox that'll take care of it right there. You have pretty much what you would expect. You've got your histogram, which will show you, if you check these little triangles up here, they'll show you where you're clipping. So if you can see the little blue that just showed up in her hair, that's where my shadows are clipping. And over here, highlights are clipping down here, you can see in the red areas. And you can make adjustments to correct that. Color temperature, we've just kind of gone through. Basic tuning tools, if you want to bring in some vibrance, if you want to bring in exposure, contrast. Contrast over in this tool I wouldn't use so much, because further down here you can see Pro Contrast and you can see Structure. You've actually got much better tools than a standard contrast slider to work with. So you have your highlights, midtones, and shadows. So not only can you choose how much contrast you're showing in there, but then you've also got your offset that will kind of help you really change what you're doing. So you can see I'm kind of exaggerating the effect here, but it gives you opportunities to open up or close down areas inside of an image with a lot more precision. So let me reset these and bring these back to normal. Structure, again, highlights, midtones, shadows, and we can bring up our midtones just a little bit. Well, actually, let's bring up our midtones quite a lot, and suddenly everything goes in there and goes haywire. This is another tool that I would probably rather use selectively rather than globally, but I just want to show how it works. Details, you have your small, medium, and large, and also your masking as well. But what I like about this is the fact that, again, you can break it down to highlights and shadows or affect the entire image. And let's not go through every little detail on here, but vignetting, you can get, you know, the 80s frosted sides if you want to go for the white border, or just pull it back over here to the other side for the other extreme and go for an extremely dark border. You've got the ability to change the size, make it smaller. You can change the roundness. You can change the feather, luminosity, and also you can place the center. So if you just want the center like right there, it doesn't have to be a vignette just smack dead center of the image. And finally, you have the ability to change the opacity of any of the effects that you're making on any layer that you do. That's pretty handy in my opinion. All right, so let's go back and take a look at a different image and see some of the things that we can do just playing around with some of the presets and some of the adjustments. So instead of a female model this time, no, we don't need to save the changes. Next one, we've got a male model, and you can see, it's kind of a warm image over there. So the first thing I want to do, go over to my temperature controls and cool it down just a little bit, because it was just a little, and that's what I get for sliding while I'm talking. It was just a little bit too warm for my taste for what I want to do for this image. And we could go down through each of these settings. You've got fine control. It's wonderful controls you've got up here, so long as you have the time to do it. But one of the things I like about using the presets is to see just how quickly you can take care of things. On the black and whites, not everyone is quite right for what you want to do. I tend to like to start off with the portrait one and just get a basic image that works for a subject. Now, the places where this comes in handy for tuning your black and white is when you start adding layers and then looking in for some of the detail enhancements. So for example, we're a little flat over here. There's not much sharpness on it. So one of the first places I do is I go start with tack sharp, and I'll push that up to 100%. Brings out nice detail on the shirt, nice detail on his hair, probably a little bit more than I want on his skin. So I'm going to make sure I've got my brush selected, and I'm going to bring the size down, and I'm just going to brush this in just in a few places. I want it on his hair. Kind of want it to go across his eyes, but and he's got a little stubble on his beard, so I want to bring that in. And I always end up doing the ears, so long as you've got places for edges, that's kind of all I want. Now, if I did this on a shirt, let's take a look here. It definitely gives it a little bit more pop, but probably not as much as I want. This is a kind of a grungy looking shirt. So let me hit the X key and I'm gonna wipe that out. What we're gonna do now is hit the plus key and we're gonna select something else. Close down the black and white. You can see I've got a few other ones over here. There's one called feature application, or amplification, sorry, and detail extractor. And all I'm really doing is I'm looking at his shirt and I'm thinking which one works the best. In this particular photo, I think feature amplification is the one I want. Again, I don't want it all over him. I just want to bring off detail on this shirt. And also on the wrapping on his hands there. And let me hit my, reveal my mask. A couple other spots I could probably get in there. Good enough for a quick video review. And just like that, I'm done. Didn't take long, didn't have to go through a lot of adjustments. All I did was turn it to black and white. I brushed in a little bit of tack sharp on his hair and eyes and face, and then I brushed in some feature amplification on his shirt. Again, I've got the amount slider. I can take it down to where we started or just bring it up. And this one, I pretty much want to go with it 100%. Once you're done, you have, as I said, your options to save this. And of course, you can export the image. You can put this back to any tool that you want to, or save it off to Facebook, mail it, send it to messages, SmugMug. It's really a handy application that has kind of a good workflow from start to finish. If you're a person that uses Lightroom or Aperture and doesn't use Photoshop, I think this is a great start to get into some of the processing of your photos beyond what you have in those tools. Photoshop is still my friend. I definitely like Photoshop, but the fact that this tool gives you so many options in one interface, I'm just really thrilled with it. I'm very happy with what I see. There are some of these tools over here you'll find on the presets particularly, you'll find work better with some images than they do with others. Some of them I found work very well for female portraits and others for male portraits. So for example, some of these kind of high contrast and grungy looks that might work on his shirt just really wouldn't apply to the previous subject that we had. The same thing is true with landscapes or architecture. You can see they've got some of these presets designed for architecture. Some of them are on portraits are just downright horrible, but they work nicely on buildings and cityscapes. So pick and choose what works for you. The name may give you an idea, or even the category of the preset may give you an idea that it shouldn't apply. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. So use your own best judgment for that. And of course, you can mark your favorites, and then once you do, just go over to favorites, and you can only pick from the ones that you want. And then if you want to create your own custom presets, you can go ahead and make your adjustments and save it as a preset, using it for whatever you want. That is my quick look at Intensify Pro from MacPhun. Again, a reminder from the name, it is for Macs. If you have Windows, this is not a plugin for you. But for the rest of you that are Mac users, it's definitely worth taking a look at. Check it out. I can certainly recommend this. And I'll be taking a look in the future at some of the other plugins and standalone tools from MacPhun. Again, this is William Beam. Thank you very much.